Okay, folks, thanks a lot for that pitch. Small sats has always been an elusive subject, and I don't know how you launch them. You didn't say that, but I don't. How do you launch them, by the way? Do you have a missile somewhere? What happened? The guy leave? Well, there you go. To kick off our afternoon now, we have Lieutenant General H.R. McMaster, and he's going to talk about Army innovation under Force 2025 and beyond.
Thanks,
sir. We got lots of innovators down here now.
Thanks, sir. Well, really, you're going to hear a lot about Army innovation from the next panel. It's really a well-put-together panel with a lot of talent and experience on it. But what I thought I might do is introduce a few themes that are really important to us as we innovate under Force 2025 and beyond. First of all, we define innovation in the Army operating concept as really our ability to turn ideas into valued outcomes. And then also to be able to do that in a way that we stay ahead of determined and increasingly capable enemies. So innovation for our Army has a qualitative dimension to it. We have to have valued outcomes, but it also has a temporal dimension to it. We have to be able to innovate at least faster than the life cycle of technology and faster than our enemies can gain advantages over us. So I'd like to talk about those two things, really what we're doing to ensure the qualitative aspect of innovation and then what we're doing to try to do it faster. Now, just a couple of caveats or qualifiers up front. We acknowledge up front in the Army operating concept that really our differential advantage over the enemy doesn't come from any single sort of suite of technologies or narrow band of technologies. What our differential advantage comes from as our Army is really our ability to combine skilled soldiers and well-trained, cohesive teams with technology and to combine them with multiple technologies. So as General Perkins said at the very beginning, we present our enemies with multiple dilemmas. And what General Sullivan said is essentially this game of rock, paper, scissors, right? That is combined arms warfare and what we're calling joint combined arms operations. So first of all, what are we doing to ensure the qualitative aspect of innovation? Really a number of things. First of all, It's the warfighting challenges as a framework, which we mentioned earlier today. I won't go into that again. But then the campaign of learning that allows us to use that framework to learn continuously in a collaborative and focused and sustained manner. So what makes for effective learning? Well, first of all, we know we have to have realistic scenarios, right? We know that successful military innovation in the past has come from really trying to solve concrete problems against real enemies and real emerging enemy capabilities. So we're working very hard on our scenarios so that they reflect the complexity of this complex world, the world that we have to win in and get to sustainable, usually political outcomes consistent with our vital interests that brought us into conflict to begin with. So we're working hard with the intelligence community, with the Joint Force, and eventually we'll be working with OSD as well to have some mature scenarios that really reflect that complexity and reflect projected enemy capabilities in a way that gives us some high fidelity. And we want to do that in a way that allows us to use those scenarios in the context of models and simulations that allows us to, every time we have a learning activity, to get a triple payoff. And this is what really John Charlton and his team have pioneered out of Fort Bliss. That triple payoff is insights that we can use and recommendations we can use, interim solutions we can use in the context of future force development. That's the payoff one for us and in our experimentation and war gaming that we're conducting. But every time that we bring leaders together, there's got to be a training payoff and a leader development payoff. So we want our learning activities to be attractive to Force Comm and Army Service Component Commands and the Joint Force and multinational partners, because they know when they bring their leaders there, they're going to grow as leaders. They're going to be able to emerge from that experience as better trained staffs and leadership teams, for example. And then the third payoff we want to get is we want to get a payoff in interoperability. So we shouldn't just be doing Army-only experiments if we know that our Army forces fight as part of joint, interorganizational, and multinational teams. So what will help us qualitatively is realistic scenarios, in realistic models and sims that have a triple payoff and bring us all together. And by the way, as we're conducting that experimentation, we're also doing the analysis, the operational analysis that will lead into the capabilities-based assessments that allows us to move our requirements through the process and develop capabilities. The second thing that we're ensuring for the qualitative aspect of this is that these are DOTMOL PF integrated solutions, doctrine, organization, training, leader development, material, personnel policy and facilities integrated solutions. So when we come out of experimentation, we're not going to brief, hey, we just need this thing. We're going to say we need this capability and we need to be able to fight this way. And based on the way we need to fight, we need to evolve our doctrine. We need to change our organization, integrate, obviously, new technologies and capabilities as part of that. But there's going to be an integrated solution that, again, will help us with this important aspect of innovation, which is to make sure that it's the qualitative aspect of it. The third key area is that we want to apply rigor to our learning. And we want to do that by bringing in outside perspectives. And those who are the real experts in this area. So if you have a realistic experiment or scenario, you have a great model and sims, but if you don't have the right people there, if you don't have the right expertise there, you're going to have a problem. And this is where our Army Service Component Commands and ForceCom in particular, they've been just heroes in this in terms of getting us really the right leaders, the right people with the right expertise. But obviously, we need to broaden that. We need to broaden that to industry. I'll talk a little bit more about that in a second, and into academia, and broadly into our multinational partners as well. Different perspectives will help us add rigor, and we want to continuously question, really, you know, our interim solutions and subject them to, you know, what some people call crowdsourcing and so forth. But everybody can participate in the framework of the warfighting challenges in the websites that you see on the handout if you head down to the booth downstairs. The other key thing that we need to do is we need to connect across the force and work on these problem sets across the force. The warfighting challenges provides that framework, but it's really the kind of relationships we develop among leaders at the appropriate levels to be able to work on the warfighting challenges, develop requirements together, and it's really the bringing together of the operators, you know, the user community, you know, which is TRADOC and ForceCom working together. It's the research and development community. I see John Wharton sitting right here, who's been a great partner in all of this. The sustainment community and AMC. It's the acquisition community and all the talent we've got with those PEOs and PMs who can help us, you know, see solutions and help modify requirements and work together as a team on developing future capabilities. And then it's the Army staff, as I mentioned earlier today, you know, that the three in terms of informing their prioritization and the eight in particular in terms of resourcing. So it's ensuring the quality of our effort has to do a great deal with collaboration. And then the other key things that we have to do is to understand that everything is a learning activity. So we have Unified Challenge, you know, which is our experimentation program that we run in the CDIDs, and then we have some larger experiments that occur during the year under TRADOC direction. And then we also have our war game. Which is Unified Quest that takes a further look out, that helps us sort of break loose a little bit from the current program force and to take a deeper look. And then we have the Army Warfighting Assessment, which is really our capstone or keystone event that gets us out in a live, virtual, and constructive environments, and we can mature concepts with mature white papers, and we can have draft requirements documents, and then use that exercise to refine them. And so with the Army Warfighting Assessment, what we want on the back end is we want really mature and well-developed solutions. So on the one side of that, that's going to be really shifts to doctrine, real mature concepts that we can bridge into doctrine quickly. But from we're looking at specific material solutions and how they fit in to a conceptual overall DOTMOL PF solution, we want really an ICD, an initial capabilities document, right on the back end of AWA and what we've learned, and being able to get your technology from industry into the hands of our soldiers faster. So I think we are on a strong path for qualitative improvements in Army innovation, how we turn ideas into valued outcomes. Now, what about the temporal dimension of this, you know, staying ahead of determined enemies? We talked a little bit about this today. We are focused very heavily on the requirements process and early collaboration in the requirements process as being really critical to that. We think that includes partnership with industry. We have to figure out the best way we can do that on a routine basis so we understand your perspective, what you can deliver, and how you could deliver it in imaginative ways and on shorter timelines. We think that our strategies for how we develop capabilities have to combine non-developmental solutions and developmental solutions. We have to look for ways that we can improve existing capabilities as well as developing new capabilities. We think that speeding this process up has a lot to do with getting ideas and equipment into the hands of soldiers earlier so we can refine those requirements and have requirements that we're confident in much earlier in the process. We think also to shorten timelines is really very strong partnership with industry and the research that you're conducting and our research and development community. So we understand technology, what maturity level it is at that time, and how we can write our requirements informed by a realistic appraisal of how we can apply technology. And so these are some of the temporal things that we're doing. What I'd like to do is quickly get to questions and to hear your advice that you might have for me and for our team. But I thought I'd talk really by way of conclusion about four risks to our ability to innovate and what we might do together to mitigate those risks. Some of these risks are identified in again the highly readable Army operating concept in Annex D. Okay, so you have Annex B. Just don't give up at the annexes because it gets even better. So in B, we have really how we go from concepts to capabilities. C is on technology, and both of those have some first principles associated with future force development and with the application of technology to our problem set. And then Annex D is on risk. So this isn't exactly parallel with that. But first of all, I think the biggest risk that we have today is the development of concepts that are inconsistent with the enduring nature of war. And what we see today is really an effort, I think, to simplify this complex problem of future war and to essentially make it a targeting exercise. Now, this is not a new phenomenon, okay? This is, you know, we call it at TRADOC the vampire fallacy because you can't kill it. It comes back like every 10 years. And the idea is that, you know, really, the next technology we develop is going to make this next war fundamentally different from all those that have gone before it. We'll be able to solve that problem through exclusively standoff capabilities and precision targeting and precision strike in particular. This is one of these, I think, fallacies that could really build vulnerabilities into our national defense, because if we build a joint force that's biased in favor of this narrow range of capabilities, you know, we could find ourselves in the position that Michael Howard warned against, right? I mean, make sure that you're not so far off the mark that you can't recover once the real demands of war reveal themselves. I think another fallacy that we have to really discuss and is an obstacle to innovation, effective innovation, is, you know, what we've called jokingly the Mutual of Omaha Wild Kingdom fallacy, which is, you know, essentially that we can rely on proxies to do the fighting for us. And we'll be in the role of Marlon Perkins from that old show, for those who can remember it. And we'll just get Jim, you know, other armies to do the fighting for us. Now, both of these are super important capabilities, right? I mean, you know, who doesn't want our tremendous precision strike and ISR type capabilities? Who thinks here that we're not going to have to work with multinational partners? And there's going to be an even higher demand on our special forces teams and our conventional forces to operate with them. But these are capabilities. These are not defense strategies. So I think this is the first really risk to innovation, are really theories and ideas, you know, about future war that cut against war's political nature, war's human nature, war's uncertainty, and war is a contest of wills. And so we can mitigate that risk by communicating effectively. And sometimes we don't do that as effectively as we could. I think, you know, we're all students of war and warfare. I think we have to get better at explaining what many of us take for granted in particular, in terms of the value of land forces operating as part of joint interorganizational multinational teams and the criticality of land force capabilities in particular. The second is related to the first, is this idea that technology alone, you know, can solve the complex problem of future war. And this could drive us toward developing a technological capability without a clear idea of how that capability interacts, right, with determined and elusive and increasingly more capable enemies, and how we integrate that technology, as I mentioned before, into DOTMAL PF integrated, really integrated solutions to our problem sets. The way we're going to do that, I think I already mentioned, really is the way we learn and the way we develop solutions. And the way we think about future war, and I'll talk about that in a second. The third related to this is that we can develop some sort of a leap ahead capability, that we can look far into the future, and that we can decide here's the capability we want to have, and it's going to be so darn good and unassailable that we'll be able to, you know, to have decisive effects on the enemy with this leap ahead capability. And of course, the problem with thinking about future capabilities that way is that we're continuously interacting with enemies, as we know, inside of conflicts. We're also continuously interacting with potential adversaries and enemies in between conflicts as well. And so if we bank on a narrow range of capabilities of exquisite technology in particular that we're going to develop far into the future, and we set off on that path, we can just about be assured that that technology will have a very limited impact in a future conflict, because our enemies will have advanced notice of this and be able to take action to circumvent it. Or again, the point that, you know, two ways to fight us, asymmetrically and stupid, right? And we can't assume that our enemies are gonna pick stupid. And then finally, the risk is that we'll under-resource our innovation efforts, you know, and it's great for us to say how thoughtful we're gonna be, right? How clever we're gonna be. But you know, if a very, very clever force that doesn't have the tools it needs or the capacity it needs to operate, you know, at sufficient scale and for ample duration to accomplish the mission, is going to be at risk. So I think our efforts are aimed at really two objectives: improve, you know, innovate overall, but innovate with a high degree of quality, innovate faster. And to do that with using the framework of the warfighting challenges, using our learning our learning events and our campaign of learning under Force 2025 maneuvers, and all the while, though, having an eye toward implementation and bridging into implementation. And so finally, I'll just say the framework that we're using as we think about future armed conflict is those warfighting challenges. Within each of those warfighting challenges, we consider really five things, four key factors and one consideration. The first factor of these is threats, enemies, and adversaries in that future operating environment. So making that grounded projection into the future, thinking about emerging threat capabilities, you know, in cyber, in lethality, in UAS and swarm UAS, and in technologies that are going to be, I think, you know, really challenging our freedom of movement and action in the air, maritime, space, cyber, and cyber domains. Enemy long-range strike capabilities, access to satellite capabilities, ability to disrupt our network strike capabilities. So technology, understanding threat technologies, but then also looking at our technologies. And General, I already mentioned those today, those areas. I see Mary Miller here. You know, our areas that we're really focused on, where we see that maturing technology can help us maintain that differential advantage over the enemy, and that's power and energy, and it's robotics, it's lethality, it's protection and material science. So focusing on those areas, we think we've got high payoff. So technology is the first factor. The second is missions. What missions do we see ourselves conducting in the future? And of course, that's going to be continuously changing. I mean, just look what's happened in the last 18 months in the world, and what that has highlighted in terms of the need for ready land forces to shape security environments, prevent conflict, and when necessary, win. So missions is the second thing that we're looking at as we evaluate within each of the warfighting challenges. The third, is history and lessons learned. What are we learning? You know, what are we learning from today that we can apply to the future? So it's threats, missions, technology, history and lessons learned are the four factors. And then we're also, within each of the warfighting challenges, looking at assets we have today and opportunities to use them differently, as well as opportunities to divest of equipment and other capabilities that we no longer need. So I'd like to hear what's on your mind, what questions you have. I just want to take this opportunity, though, to thank all of you in industry. We don't get a chance to thank you enough for what you do. I mean, you are critical to our differential advantage over our enemies, and sometimes it's hard for you to see the tangible payoff of your work, but our soldiers see that every day who are fighting in formations that have the capabilities that you've developed. So you will never see, you will never know how many of our soldiers will get to see their children grow up because of what you do every day. So I just want to say thanks on behalf of our Army, and I'm happy to hear where you'd like to take the discussion. All right, great. Okay. Okay, I'll go to the podium for this, and then so we have, okay. Tom, did you get the planted question in here? No, I was just kidding. Okay, so, all right, so how are we doing it, including international partners in our innovation process? How do we handle or counter the Buy American conventional wisdom? Okay, so, so here's some of the things that we're doing, and a great question. First of all, the Army Warfighting Assessment is setting the tone for that. That is a multinational event, and John Charlton will be here, and Colonel Smallwood is going to be giving a talk about this. It's on the agenda. I'd ask you to attend that. So we have very strong multinational participation there, but we are operating every day with allies and partners, and we're learning from each other in the area of interoperability, but also best practices, right? I mean, we talked today about what we're learning from the Ukrainian military as they're facing this threat from the Russians. So our real bridge into that learning is through our Army Service Component Commanders, our brigade and division commanders who are interacting with our partners. And so we have a very strong bridge into exercises like Pacific Pathways, into strong Europe. And so we are learning from each other every day. We also have a very mature LNO exchange network out there for technology, but also with our TRADOC LNOs. I mean, when I was at Fort Benning, that was one of the greatest gifts to us at Fort Benning, were our liaison officers. And we worked together on specific projects. I mean, as we're revising doctrine, as we're developing future capabilities, as we're developing requirements documents, we're reading each other's documents, commenting, working together in a collaborative manner. I think that in terms of the Buy American part and looking at other options, I think we need to do that with as we look at analysis of alternatives, right, for weapon systems and capabilities. And we're looking very hard. You know, future fighting vehicle is something we've needed, right? I mean, the Bradley is already approaching obsolescence. We need a new fighting vehicle. We did a non-developmental study based on the requirements that we generated for the ground combat vehicle, which we're modifying now. But we'll do that again. And what we found is we had certain armored vehicles, for example, had you know, an element. I mean, some of the requirements that we needed, but none of them put it all together, right? And this is one of those areas, you know, for example, you know, you don't want to have the second best fighting vehicle. Do you know what I mean? I mean, when you're up against the enemy in close combat, you want smoke and boots on the other end. You don't want a fair fight. So evaluate other capabilities with an eye toward best ideas and what you can incorporate, but at the same time recognizing some of those capabilities that you want to have that overmatch, you know, and to actually have a developmental project. Okay, so I'm not even scanning these ahead, so I'm not even editing these. Okay, earlier you spoke of connecting the user with the developer. There are so many rice bowls that went into the process. How do you get in more responsive to jointly develop capabilities? Okay, that's a great question. Okay, so what we have found is by elevating the discussion, right, just by not focusing on exclusively on a thing, but instead on the capability, then this is what General Perkins has been emphasizing on a really, you know, continuous basis for us and challenging us to do. You begin to understand what people are bringing in just parochial considerations without a really clear idea of how much those considerations or ideas or efforts or programs are contributing to a real capability. So I think one of the ways we're getting at that is just the framework of the Army warfighting challenges. How does this thing, how does your you know, warfighting function as it's represented in this thing or whatever contribute to what we have to do as an Army? And that's, I think, helped us identify some opportunities and to get beyond, you know, which is the understandable parochialism and pride that we have in branches and certain narrow capabilities, or our desire to see programs succeed, for example, even maybe when it's time to divest and move on to something else. Okay, all right. So since the Army won't have material breakthroughs for a while, no GCV, for example, a modest AMPV, how much can we change, how much can we change so we can fight with the current material? All right, so this is the approach we're taking with what is in draft now, a combat vehicle modernization strategy. When it's in final draft, we want to get it out to industry. We want to get it out to, I think, pretty soon. General Perkins is going to brief this soon to the Army Secretariat, the Army Management Action Group. We're going to get some feedback there. We're already getting some feedback from across the force and from AMC and RDECOM. And Paul Rogers, obviously, is playing a huge role in this at TRADOC. So what we want to do is we can't just develop a new thing only, right? We have to develop a new thing. We have to sustain what we have. We have to improve other things that we have. We have to replace old equipment. So we have to take on a broad range of activity to give us, to maintain that differential advantage over the enemy. So in the combat vehicle portfolio, for example, what do we say? We say, okay, our goal is overmatch, right? Again, no fair fights, okay? Firefight ending capability in every formation, overmatch in every formation. Each formation, we're saying, needs to have the appropriate combination of mobility, protection, and lethality to accomplish the mission under the mission variables, MET TC consideration, mission enemy troops, terrain, time, civilian considerations, under which that formation is committed. So what we have said is that we are about to lose overmatch in all three of those formations, and we need to do some things very quickly to improve lethality and to improve mobility. Our initial emphasis is going to be on IBCTs. We're looking at some GOTS, you know, and COTS solutions to get greater mobility into early entry forces in particular, but also to bring in some firepower in the form of a light reconnaissance vehicle, which we think, you know, it's not any new technology. It's going to be combinations of technologies already mature that will give us an offensive security capability and a real reconnaissance capability that can allow infantry to move, you know, mounted on trucks or dismounted in an approach march when they're vulnerable, protect them, right, as they're moving toward an assault or an attack position after arriving at an offset objective. This is part of expeditionary maneuver. We also recognize, though, that we need mobile protected firepower across all of our formations to ensure freedom of movement and action in close contact with the enemy. So we think in the IBCT, that's a new development. I mean, it's a light tank, essentially, that is able to operate in restrictive and urban terrain, that is conducive to getting in quickly during early and forcible entry operations, and can provide that capability within IBCTs but across the formation. In SBCTs, just to give more examples, you know, we think that we can upgrade very quickly. We want to upgrade very quickly the lethality on the Striker. So, you know, on our Striker vehicles, we have a very capable platform that can move over across operational distances. The formation is designed and will remain designed to fight dismounted. But, you know, you don't get a chance to really pick all the time when you're going to encounter the enemy. So when encounter actions with the enemy, we want to overmatch that enemy, and you can't do that with a World War II weapon system. So how do we upgrade Strikers quickly so this is something we can do in the short term? And as everybody knows, you know, the M1 tank, the Bradley we have, I mean, it's nothing like the M1 tank and the Bradley when they were first came out off the assembly line. So we have done, I think, a very good job in terms of engineer change proposals. You've done a very good job at allowing us to get the most out of those platforms to stay ahead of change, to maintain the best fighting vehicle and the best tank over decades in our Army. So great question. The key is we can't just only do development. We have to undertake a broad range of activities. And we're trying to do that within the limited resources we have, you know, through prioritization. And then I think we've got to make the case better for more resources. You know, we're investing, as you know, very heavily, as we should in a nation, in our air and maritime supremacy and dominance. Of course, the domain that is most contested is land, right? Because, I mean, technology, as we know, has limited penetration on land for all sorts of reasons. It's where people live, right? Geography complicates things. You have tens of thousands of so-called targets, all of whom are trying to avoid being classified as such, right? So you have complicating things on land. And so I think we have to make the argument better that we need to invest more in our differential advantage on land, because it's our soldiers and Marines are doing the fighting there and need to have that advantage. Okay, how much time do I have, guys? 1 minute, okay. How is the new Defense Innovation Initiative a continuity or departure from the Army's current research and development efforts? Okay, I think what we have to do is we have to participate fully in that innovation initiative, and I think we have to help, you know, maybe shape the framework of it and its outcomes by bringing our expertise, right, as land forces into that discussion. So none of us in the Army, right? I mean, are against Air Force or naval capabilities. I mean, we can't even get to the fight without them, right? I mean, when's the last time any of us in this room had to, never, right, had to look up and say, well, is it friendly or enemy? I mean, we love our Air Force. We love the strategic mobility. We love the, you know, the firepower, the support, what they've done to allow us to operate more widely dispersed while maintaining mutual support. But we have to make clear what our, you know, what we need to help maintain the differential advantage, not only on land to defeat enemy organizations, to control terrain and secure populations, but we think increasingly in the future to project power outward from land into the maritime, air, space, and cyber domains to help ensure freedom of movement and action of our sister services. As those domains become more challenged, our Army is going to play an increasingly important role in integrating joint capabilities across domains and then supporting, you know, our sister services to ensure that they retain freedom of movement and action. So, and you know, there are historical, you know, examples of this, right? I mean, you know, how did we deal with the V1 and V2 threat to London in World War II? That was a joint, that had to be a joint operation. That wasn't only from standoff capabilities. Look at the Scud missile threat, you know, to Israel in 1991. Rocket threats out of southern Lebanon and Gaza. What did it take to do that? It took really a full range of joint capabilities. Thank you. Thank you so much for the privilege of being with you. And you got a great panel coming up. It's going to be better than cats. It's going to be awesome. Thanks.